Good morning and good afternoon. Thank you all for joining our event, Creating Exceptional Women Leaders, the Missing Links of Mentorship and Networking. My name is Olivia. I am a senior program coordinator at the Harvard Global Health Institute, and I will be the MC for today's event. I would like to welcome Dr. Ingrid Katz, who will be providing us with opening remarks. Dr. Katz is the Associate Faculty Director at the Harvard Global Health Institute and an Associate Physician in the Department of Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Katz. I will now turn it over to you.
Thank you so much for your warm welcome, Olivia, and good morning and good afternoon, everyone. And again, welcome to our CUGH satellite event hosted today by the Harvard Global Health Institute. First, I'd like to thank CUGH for providing us with the opportunity to host this event. I would also like to thank all of our tremendous speakers who are joining us today, many of whom are 2019 and 2020 Harvard Global Health Institute Lead Fellows for Promoting Women in Global Health, which is a fellowship opportunity provided by the Harvard Global Health Institute and the Women in Health Initiative at the T.H. Chan School of Public Health. You will learn more about this fellowship during the event today. Lastly, thank you to our attendees for joining us. I expect you'll find this immersive leadership experience to be directly applicable to your own work. And I encourage you to use this time to network and engage directly with other attendees. To begin, I'd like to give a brief overview of today's events. The event today will be 3 hours in duration, and we will integrate breaks periodically throughout the course of the event to provide ample time for coffee and restroom breaks. The event is broken up into 3 distinct sessions. During the first session, we will hear from my colleague, Dr. Anna Langer, on the importance of leadership and mentorship for women in global health. We will then be joined by the 2019 and 2020 Lead Fellow, Dr. Shabnam Shafraz and Cynthia Mambo, who will share some key takeaways from their Lead Fellowship experiences at the Harvard Global Health Institute. Our second session kicks off with a skills workshop with executive leadership coach, Jacqueline Franklin. Attendees will then take these skills with them into breakout rooms for the rest of the session with our lead fellows, Dr. Stella Bivol, Carmen Contreras, Maureen Luba, and Dr. Shubha Raghavan, guiding you through additional leadership training. Our third and final centers focus primarily on networking, a critical component to our event today, where you will have the opportunity to break into smaller groups to meet with one another and to meet with our terrific lead fellows. Before we get started, I would just like to outline a few housekeeping rules. So today the video is being streamed through Zoom. It is being recorded and will be made available on our website at the Harvard Global Health Institute after this event concludes. Second, while some of the sessions today will involve breakout room discussions and will request your participation, we do ask that you keep yourself muted during presentations and while others are speaking. Third, during the course of the event, we have 2 wonderful colleagues from the Harvard Global Health Institute who will be here to provide tech support. So if you're having any technical issues at all, please feel free to directly chat with either Luke or Scarlett, both of whom have the name HGHI Tech Support in their titles. Fourth and finally, we've also enabled the chat function, which we will be monitoring and overseen by my colleague, Luke. So to get us started, I'd like all of us today to use the chat functionality to let us know where you're connecting from, including the city and the country. So I'm calling in from Cambridge, Massachusetts in the United States today. And if you'd like to enter into your chat function where you're located, that's a wonderful way to get to know everyone. And with that, I'll hand it back to Olivia, who will introduce our first session of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Katz. We will now move to our session titled Women in Global Health, Spotlight on Mentorship and Networking, led by Dr. Anna Langer. Dr. Langer is the director of the Women in Health Initiative and professor in public health in the Department of Global Health and Population at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. Dr. Langer, I will now turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Olivia, for that kind introduction. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. Let me now share my screen. Sorry, 1 minute. Oh. That always happens, right? Here, let me. I'm having some difficulties now. Can you see my screen? No. Can you see my screen?
No.
Yeah. Let me see. Share. Sorry, can you help me here? Look, maybe. Oh, here. Can you see it now?
Yeah, go up.
Perfect. Thank you to the gods of Zoom and technology for helping me solve this problem. So again, thank you so much for the kind introduction and welcome everyone to this session. Let me tell you a little bit about two key components of the LEAD Fellowship. But let me start by saying that LEAD is the name of our program, and it stands for Learn, Engage, Advance, and Disrupt. Our leadership program is focused on strengthening women's leadership in global health. And it is quite unique among the range of opportunities available for training of this kind. The discussion today is a very, very timely and relevant, one day after International Women's Day and 2 days away from the anniversary of the official start of the COVID pandemic, when the World Health Organization declared it a pandemic on March 11 last year. The pandemic has deeply affected women's health and lives, and the leadership in our LEAD Fellowship, we think, fills an important gap. My short presentation will address two critical components of our program, mentoring and networking. We have some working definitions of these two sets of activities that you can see on your slide. Mentoring, it's the process of engaging with colleagues to nurture, develop, and maximize leadership competencies and skills. And networking is the process of building mutually beneficial relationships and connecting for purposes of health, advice, information, resources, and well-being. These two constructs are very, very closely linked. While networking does not necessarily include mentorship, mentorship does involve expanding mentees' networks. Why are mentoring and networking so critical, particularly now? This is a time when stronger, responsive, agile, and evidence-based leadership in global health is needed. This type of leadership is always essential, but even more so in times of crisis. Networking among global health professionals across countries is also essential. However, networking, collaboration, and collaborative evidence generation are not routinely taught in public health curricula. Goal of current public health education is competence in public health science. That circumvents knowledge and training of leadership skills like creativity, competence to collaborate, teamwork, management, resource mobilization, and communication that are largely taught in business schools, but skip public health academics. Beyond traditional core public health areas, public health professionals of the future, of the present and the future, I would say, need to be able to identify and connect with role models, to communicate with multidisciplinary professionals, use new information systems, collaborate for research, have strong multidisciplinary linkages, and allies at different levels, leadership, management, and supervisory levels. Our program is designed to address the gaps of formalized mentorship support to public health professionals in academic institutions. COVID has magnified the need and the urgency. Why a focus on women? Women are underrepresented in leadership in global health, public health, medicine, and life sciences. The cost of such a gap is huge. Indeed, women are agents of change when they fulfill their potential and occupy leadership positions. They implement policies that create better lives for families, communities, and nations, as research shows. They find ways to support and lift women and children who continue to experience a disproportionate burden of disease and death worldwide. Proactive action is needed now. Contributing to narrowing the gaps in women's leadership in global health is the core goal of the LEAD Fellowship. Let's go now to mentorship. What are the elements of mentorship? Among others, some of them intangible, mentorship strengthens multiple leadership skills: knowledge development skills, negotiation and communication skills, networking and team building skills, career counseling, planning and goal setting, achieving work-life balance, exposure to opportunities for collaborations. At LEAD, we address all of them. Consistently with our core values as public health scientists, we want to generate evidence to demonstrate the effectiveness of our efforts in the area of mentorship. For that, we identified some core indicators that will help us document and track our progress. You can see on the slide that we are very, very interested in documenting how fellows are doing in terms of facilitation with their next career moves, improved technical skills and knowledge, access to learning resources, access to mentors, expanded network, access to conferences, seminars, workshops, inclusion in joint projects, scholarship, fellowships, and training avenues, and of course, joint publications. Moving now to networking. What does networking do for us? It helps expand one's perception of the world from a limited local perspective to a more global view. Expands one's reasoning ability as different ideas and different voices, supports us during challenging times, helps us identify and seize opportunities, connects us with role models, including mentors. It also opens our minds to new approaches, methods, and concepts. Ideally, we enjoy the networking opportunities that multiple sources provide. Mentors can offer advice, support, and coaching. Strategizers share insider information. Connectors make interactions for us. Opportunity givers tell us about high visibility occasions. And advocates support us for promotions and other pivotal moments in our careers. Sometimes we are lucky enough to benefit from an executive level sponsor and who provide critical support for the advancement of our professions. You will hear much more about this during the session. But before I pass the floor back to Olivia, let me give you a quick description of where we are with the LEAD Fellowship. We recruited an amazing group of women from low and middle income countries. The 2019 and 2020 cohorts come from a wide range of countries. The first cohort brings together women from Pakistan, Moldova, India, and Malawi. The second cohort, 3 women leaders from Malawi, Peru, and Bosnia. They were invited to join LEAD after a very rigorous selection process, a very competitive one, I must say. Our approach is bottom up, and we focus on the realities of the global South. We encourage our fellows to customize their learning and fellowship journey as per their own professional needs, passions, and interests. And most importantly, their expectations and needs of mentorship and networking. Our fellows are agents of change. In their home countries and beyond, they will expand the learning and networking circle through the mentorship they themselves provide and the networking opportunities they open for others. Thank you so much for joining us today for this important session. I turn it back to Olivia now to help us move to the next part of the event. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Langer. We are thrilled to share a brief video titled Leadership Labyrinth, the difference that mentors and networks make. In this video, you will hear from inspiring women in the field of global health who will draw from their own lived experiences to reflect on the importance of mentorship and networking.
Build your network before you need it. It's very, very clear when you come in because I need a letter of recommendation from you. But when you do it and you're your authentic self, you choose things that bring you joy or something that you want to learn and do it your best, then ultimately, when you need a recommendation or someone to think of you, it's just going to be so natural, you know, because the truth is when you gift mentorship and you truly find the true match of mentor and mentee, then you just can never know. The only difference between me and my mentors is time. So they just don't know who Judy will be in 5 years or 10 years. And so you're making an investment that you really cannot tell how it's going to be.
Being a mentee, so having mentors is definitely helpful. Not only it brings you a lot of life lessons, I feel, it gave me a lot of inspiration and it's definitely opens your mind and you start to think also in different ways that you haven't had the habit to do. The fact that they are more senior in their role in general, your mentors, in the classic format, then you get access to a whole new network as well. And when you start your career, that is tremendously valuable because you have to start building all your relationships and having access to people who may have an answer to your questions is so much more facilitator. I think being a mentor yourself is even more impactful. I love to be a mentee, but I think I get much more out of the relationship in the bi-directional way.
If I can mentor a young person, if I can mentor a friend, a professional colleague, even not necessarily even just in the global health field, which I do, and shorten that journey for them, then we are contributing to a better world for women, for a world where women begin to see that they don't have to struggle as hard to get to where they want to be in their careers. It opens a world of possibilities because mentorship at high level means that you're a door opener. In a world of COVID, that conversation has to change because we're all meeting like this and get possibly for the next year. Being very clear about your intention, being very clear about what you need, particularly right now, where we're all on speed dial, we're all overworked, stating your intent, not just, you know, hello, I would like you to be my mentor. No, what does that mean to you? What direction are you trying to get to in life and how far are you trying to go? You know, you can't necessarily attend conferences anymore, which is a huge shame. Camaraderie and the connection that brings was sadly missing in the world of today. But the networking is still important. You know, it is making sure you insert yourselves into the right professional structures, showing what you bring to the table. What is your unique selling point? What is your added value? It is critical, particularly right now.
If you have a good network, it's important you don't lose it. And this is something I sometimes neglected because you just move on with the flow of life that just overtakes in phases or in waves like we now had, and then you lose a lot of the connections. So the maintenance of it is even more difficult than the establishment of a network.
What I can say to anyone who's watching this is that you know, be your authentic self, build your network before you need it. But number three is always be able to recognize when you're in the right place at the right time. That sometimes eludes a lot of us. And so the network may be the right time and you just completely missed the opportunity. What I would say ultimately though, you have to find the right fit. It's a little bit almost like dating. You have to find someone you have chemistry with to be able to enjoy growing together, because it's not just for mentees that these relationships are important. It's also the other way around.
Oh, what advice. First and foremost, make up your mind what you want out of the relationship. Do you want to get the network access, or you want to rebuild a skill, or you're just inspired by the person and you want to learn? And the diversity is what brings you most. We all know that diversity is key to creativity, and creativity is key to solve the most difficult problems. So having a range of mentors is definitely an advice I would give. And both from formal and informal types.
And you always not, you're so grateful when you're the mentor of the opportunities that other people have provided to you. And when you're the mentee, you're grateful for the time, and you show respect for the time and the effort that you get from your mentorship, from your mentorship relationship.
Never, ever give up. Because there are times when it will feel difficult. We're still not there yet. We're doing great things around the world, you know, where we have women presidents, and every one of those steps gives me goosebumps. Every one of those women I celebrate. But I also celebrate every young woman who I see rise up in her career to that whole next level. Look to those who have gone ahead of you. Reach out to those mentors or form community around yourself, a supportive community of champions. So I'm a leader because I'm passionate. I'm a leader because I want to see change, not just because I want to be a leader. And you get up and you do another day.
Our next session is titled Lead Fellowship, an Unparalleled Experience. This session is co-led by our 2019 Lead Fellow, Dr. Shabnam Sarfraz. Dr. Sarfraz is a member of the Social Sector Planning Commission in the Government of Pakistan and is a senior technical advisor to the P2I Pathway to Impact in Pakistan. Dr. Sarfraz is joined by our 2020 Lead Fellow, Cynthia Mambo. Cynthia serves as the Deputy PEPFAR Coordinator for the U.S. Embassy in Malawi. I will now turn it over to you both.
Thank you so much, Olivia. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. I'm Cynthia Mambo from Malawi, a 2020 fellow for the Global Health Lead Fellowship. And most of you, I'm sure, are wondering what is LEAD. LEAD is Leaders for Equality, Advancement, and Diversity. This fellowship was launched by the Harvard Global Health Institute in 2019. And the fellowship aims at equipping but also empowering women leaders in global health, and is open to those with over 15 years of professional and demonstrated leadership experience. Together with my colleague Shabnam, a 2019 fellow from Pakistan, we'll try to share with you the depth and breadth that this fellowship program offers. We'll be reflecting on our own experiences and our resolve to taking our learning to a wider group of aspiring leaders across the globe. Just to introduce to you some of the fellows that have done this fellowship. So initially we had a 2019 cohort, and from the far left, you have Siyash Sabrisa from India. You have Stella Bevel from Moldova. You have Shabnam Sarfraz from Pakistan. My colleague Maureen Luba from Malawi. Myself, Cynthia from Malawi. Ida Kodvik from Bosnia. And Carmen Cortez from Peru. So you see that we are a diverse group and trying to share our learning experiences. Well, the Harvard LEAD Fellowship is really transformative, I can say. Experiences that, you know, have designed and empowered the emerging leaders, but also developing our potential in global health. So fellows have access to a world-class faculty. We're provided with two senior mentors, audit courses, and select executive educative programs that align with our own unique personal growth and our leadership plans. Based on our specific interests and leadership goals, we also engage in tailored leadership training programs and speaking opportunities and also networking opportunities, and have an opportunity to even work on our independent projects that we have to focus on. In addition to that, there's a cluster of activities that include active participation in forums, seminars, mentoring students, and also young faculty. We actively participate in conversations and working collaboratively with faculty and other independent projects. The resident period now concludes with an in-depth reintegration plan facilitated by distance support during the remaining months of the fellowship. The fellowship also offers a really unique opportunity to build global network of peers, working relationships across different schools and departments of the Harvard University. This serves as a springboard for innovative ideas, which encourage and challenge us in new and inspiring ways, and we are valuable in expanding one's reasoning ability. It also helped us expand our view of the world from a limited local perspective to a more expanded global view. My colleague Shabnam will now share with you more about our experiences. Over to you, Shabnam.
Thanks, Cynthia. During the fellowship, we are also appointed as visiting scientists at the Harvard THN School, which houses the Women in Health Initiative, and that is actually where the fellowship originated. The fellowship graciously opens doors for us to take advantage of the vast intellectual resources that were available at the various schools and departments of the university, and most importantly, gave us the complete freedom to individually design our time at Harvard. It is indeed an unparalleled experience where one has the privilege to not only discovering oneself, but also creating ourselves to the sort of leaders that we have always aspired for. The fellowship specifically designed to promote leadership skill in individuals who will in turn mentor future leaders in global health. This was a passion which we all together carried as we moved along, identifying and recruiting mentees and running mentorship sessions, not only at Harvard, but even at other universities. Our time at Harvard was like walking through a path that was much more beautiful than the wildest of our dreams. It has been a time to reflect, recalibrate, and explore uncharted territories. It provided us with this protected space and time to reflect on our personal experiences, our decisions, our stumbles, and our achievements, recognize our leadership style, and most importantly, identify our blind spots. Harvard is not a university where one comes to collect certificates only. It is where we were offered a learning and networking opportunity of a lifetime. After the initial 4 months of intensive resident period, building extensive professional networks, strengthening our leadership skills, and mastering negotiation across geographic boundaries, cultures, sectors, and organizations, we, the 2019 fellows, returned to our home countries and entered another exciting phase of translating the newly acquired skills and knowledge to drive performance for optimal results. Confronted by COVID-19, we courageously and effectively exercised adaptive leadership strategies and influence managed the individual and institutional dynamics while being actively supported virtually by our mentors and the executive leadership coach, who I must say were instrumental in providing us with the anchoring system we needed while passing through the times of chaos and crisis. For the 2020 cohort, it turned out to be a completely different experience as the university switched to a complete virtual mode of learning during COVID-19. There were no in-person classes, networking was challenged, and so were managing the fellowship activities while being in different time zones. However, it turned out to be an equally exhilarating experience as the student engagement, faculty interaction, and the learning experience were taken to another level. We all had access to best known expertise at the discussion forums and availed this unique opportunity to maximize our time in learning how to build back better. We are committed to making all possible efforts to exploit the world-class learning, the valuable linkages, the extensive networking for a spillover effect, and sharing it with a much wider group. We are designing the LEAD mentorship program and hope that one day we would be able to together take the work forward, impacting the lives of millions around us. Our deep commitment is to paving paths for future leaders, for which we are planning multiple initiatives. If you're looking to sharpen your leadership skills, which are necessary to working with diverse stakeholders in contested arenas, for introducing innovative approaches to addressing the public health challenges at the highest policy levels, I must say there's nothing that offers this better than the Harvard Global Health Institute LEAD Fellowship. I would like to end with this quote from Dolly Parton, which has always inspired me. If your actions create a legacy that inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, then you are an excellent leader. In many ways, this fellowship would not be possible if it was not for the generosity of one of our donors, Jane G's son. She's an innovative global leader and a champion of diversity in one of China's most high-profile companies, Citrip. Jane was named by Forbes as one of the emerging 25 Asia's latest star businesswomen in 2018 and one of the most influential and outstanding businesswomen in China in 2017. She's also listed as one of the Fortune's top 50 most powerful women in business and is a recipient of Asia Game Changer Award in 2019. As a fearless leader that she is, Jane spearheaded multiple bold and innovative initiatives to support and promote women across the globe, one being the launch of the Jane G's Son LEAD Fellowship at the Harvard Global Health Institute in 2019 that we introduced to you. Let's now hear directly from Jane on her motivation behind the launch of this and what networking and mentorship means to us. Over to you, Jane.
Thanks for having me. I feel great honor to have this opportunity to participate in this wonderful event. I feel very blessed for the opportunity that I met with Dean in the School of Public Health in Harvard. And At the time, I thought, what a great opportunity if we can do something together to encourage the leaders in the public health to help each other in the global network. And it just happened right before the coronavirus took a hit on the world. So when we did our recap for this program, again, I feel very blessed for this opportunity. And I think this program will light the torch in the future to encourage more and more women join force and help each other, help their community, help their nation to fight against the pandemics in the future. I feel mentorship and network are very critical for the career development and healthiness of female leaders and female friends in the global places. There are a couple of things I have noticed. In the workplace, normally females enjoy the environment that we can communicate, and we are very good with team buildings, very good with putting ourselves in other people's shoes, very good with being very willing to make personal sacrifice for the best interests of the team. So that's why I think to have a good network which offers good mentorship is very critical, particularly for the young females who are entering into the workforce, who are entering into the college, who start a new chapter of their lives. If we can help each other by sharing our experience and encourage each other during the time when we have pressure, I think our life will be filled with more inspiration. I would love to share my personal story with you. When I came to the USA, I worked in a restaurant making three $1,000 per hour to make myself, make my ends meet. But my professor's family were very kind to me. They took me in and treated me as their own daughter. So I told my professor's family that someday when I'm able to, I want to take good care of them. But they told me, oh, honey, you don't need to take care of us. Instead, if you can help the international student who worked so hard, try to be successful in the same way as we help you, that would be wonderful. So although at that time I was penniless, I always had a dream that someday, if I'm able to, I want to establish a scholarship to help the international students to be successful. So I was very glad in 2016, I went back to my school and established a scholarship named after my professor. And the LEADER program, again, is very much under their influence with the mind to help more international females to help each other. So I think the role model my professor and his wife has established for me changed my life and laid out my strong foundation in getting the community, giving our world everything I can, and help the students, help our female leaders, help other young people to be successful. If we can encourage ourselves and push ourselves out of the comfort zone, we will be able to take on more responsibility. So at year end, a lot of male employees will come to my office, ask for raises, ask for promotion. But for my female employees, very few of them do that. I think we deserve to be recognized. We need to work hard, but on the other hand, we also need to dare to push ourselves to take on more responsibility and take on more share of the responsibility within a bigger organization and always step up and step out from our comfort zone.
Thank you, Shabnam, Cynthia, and Jane. We will now break for 5 minutes. Please stretch, turn off your cameras, and refresh your coffee or tea. We will see you back here in 5 minutes, where we will engage with Executive Leadership Coach Jacqueline Franklin.
Great. Hello, everybody. It's so great to, well, maybe not see everyone, but to certainly hear everyone. And I've been watching the chat, and there's been so much great enthusiasm. It's great to have everyone here. I have had the distinct pleasure of working with these fellows over the last year and a half, and I have to say it's both exciting and humbling. These women are phenomenal leaders and continuing to grow as every leader does. So as Olivia said, I've been an executive coach for this group, as well as my own clients, and I help people from around the globe really work to be the best that they can be as leaders. So let me move on to our agenda here. So I'm going to spend a lot of time on mentoring and networking, but I'll also share plenty more on the notion of leadership. And I'll put it in a context of a framework that revolves around this notion of developing yourself and others as a key differentiator for leadership. I'll use slides, but get ready to participate along the way. I'm going to ask you to type in some chats, and we have a poll, and we'll keep it as interactive as we can in a forum this large. So, what is the action of leading? So, you know, if you look on Google, you will get myriad definitions of leadership. I just picked out one that seemed like the simplest that we could all embrace. And it's the action of leading a group of people or an organization. However, you probably notice it has the word leading in the definition. So for our first exercise, I would like to ask you to type into chat what elements or competencies come to mind for you when you see leadership in action. Go ahead and type in. Terrific. Service, compassion, empathy, responsibility, vision, support, agility, the big C's, competencies, confidence, charisma, encouragement, more support, compassion. Beautiful words. Yeah, we could go on and on all day, right? Which is a great reminder that there's no small amount of attributes that go into great leadership, and what a tall order it is. Terrific. Thank you, everyone. Those are great. So by way of the model that I referred to earlier, let me share with you some of what, in my experience, leadership has boiled down to make it really as simplistic as we can, even though we know it's not very simplistic. And that is the notion of looking at three different areas. I'm going to start with engagement. And that is the notion of working with others. How well do you collaborate, communicate? And there's this word again, developer, meaning how well do you develop yourself and others? You saw this one peek out, transformation. This is another element. How well are you affecting change? Are you a catalyst? Are you leading with the flag, or are you leading from behind? How are you affecting change? And then lastly, how well are you putting things in a strategic framework? Are you able to lift up and look at things more from a strategic point of view? And then we look at results. Ultimately, none of us get to where we are in our careers without the ability to get things done. So this is about how well do you maximize your time? How well do you make decisions? And both of those feed into the results that you accomplish. None of this is, none of this is easy. However, wrapping it up, the common thread is really thinking about your emotional intelligence as an element to pull these together. In every single one of these little pie slices, if you will, there is an opportunity to take up your leadership another notch by exercising emotional intelligence. As you would imagine, it's rare to see a leader that resonates across all of these in a strong way. Most of us come to the table with maybe 2, 3, maybe if we're lucky, 4 of these that are our strengths, but the rest really require development. And we have to work on them. And sometimes we have to work on them depending on where we're working. So there might be cultural aspects that we have to put in play to fine tune some of these skills. So as I mentioned earlier, you know, the point here is we're really going to be working on developing self and others. And let's look at why don't some leaders do that? And the number one thing I hear from people is that it takes time. Who has time? We are so busy with our head down, accomplishing things and wanting to achieve, you know, great results, that taking time to develop ourselves, much less others, is just another thing on the to-do list. It also takes fortitude to look in the mirror and look at things that you know are not serving you well is sometimes very humbling and difficult to affect. So sometimes we don't feel like being patient with ourselves. And lastly, especially as it pertains to developing others, it can be uncomfortable. For those of you who might be a little more averse to conflict, having a conversation with someone about their work, about how they're going about things, can feel uncomfortable. And holding people to account is another fine tuning of a leadership skill. However, for those that exercise a growth mindset, excuse me, what leaders learn is that it's really the only way to scale yourself, to pull yourself up and to get more done through others, how you influence, how you leverage your team. That is one way for you to affect a greater path for yourself and others. It can also be rewarding. for those of you, and it looked like in the chat, many of you are already mentors and mentees. On both sides of the equation, it's very rewarding to help other people develop their leadership skills. And then, as I mentioned earlier, up-leveling your skills can also produce higher quality outcomes. So there's almost like this cycle. The more developed your leadership skills are, the higher the quality of the product and services you can provide. As John F. Kennedy said, I love this quote, learning and leadership are indispensable to each other. So I invite you to think about that as a part of your leadership arsenal. And that is, if I continue to learn, my leadership is only going to get improved, is only going to improve. So let's look at another model that is one of my favorites in terms of thinking about leadership. And this is looking at the relative importance of some of the key leadership skills that come to mind for folks as you progress throughout your career. So early in our careers, most of us are hired because we have some kind of functional expertise or technical value add. It's really important early in our careers to come to the table with some notion of a specialty. And this could be as simple as your specialty might be accounting, it might be a grant writer, it might be business development. I know early in my career, I was hired as an emerging sales rep, and that was my specialty at the time, believe it or not. So others, however, as we go forward, begin to get interested in or have opportunity for management. And so those skills, as we progress throughout our career, for those who aspire to manage, become much more important as well. Then lastly, here's that term again, emotional intelligence. Others will tap in to emotional intelligence to really take that leadership game up another notch. So it's not enough just to have subject matter expertise. It's not enough to know how to manage, especially projects and people, but to really understand through emotional intelligence, what's your value add? How can you develop others? And how can you influence the behavior of people so that you can accomplish more as a leader? So our next slide here is the opportunity for everybody to weigh in on a poll. So I'm going to have this poll brought up. And the first question, and even though it's not supposed to be cure, I want you to note it is curve. Which curve are you on? So go ahead and complete the poll, and we'll take a look at how that turned out for everybody. Is everybody seeing that? Oh, look at how it's switching. Oh, just to be clear, we're just working on question number one, everybody, just in case that's confusing. Just question number one, which curve are you on? The green one, the orange one, or the blue one? Looks like we have 20% in. We'll give it another minute. There we go. Okay. I'm thinking maybe some people are not seeing the poll. But we'll stop here. It looks like a pretty balanced group. We have some people that are working as subject matter expertise. And again, by the way, there's no judgment on any of these. You can still be a leader with subject matter expertise or an individual contributor. So we have, look at this balanced group. This is great. And plenty of you on that, the green curve, the emotional intelligence one. Okay, so I think we can end that poll now. Thank you. All right, so let me carry on. There we go. So let's move into developing self and others. And in chat, I would like you to chat what you believe it means to develop self. Just go ahead, what comes top of mind when somebody says, what does it mean to develop yourself as a leader? Mm-hmm. Growth. Introspection. I love that one. I would go so far as to say reflection is often the most underrated skill set of a leader. So I'm glad to see that. Self-awareness, there's reflection. Increasing my empathy. Yeah, you still have to have subject matter expertise, Sidra. That's a good point. Terrific. Yes, thank you. And then let's look at the corollary. When you are developing others, what does that look like? Go ahead and chat. Ah, feedback, listening, more self-awareness, very true. Evaluation, listening, wow, a lot of listening. Yeah, some of the same, you're absolutely right. Planning, I love that. Balancing praise with constructive criticism. These are terrific. And very appropriate. Thank you, everybody. I'm going to move on. And let's look at a couple other ways to look at this. So developing yourself and others, there's some real commonalities across both of these. So one of them is taking ownership. You'll see this notion of intentionality come through with a couple of things that I'll share with you. But it's really owning your development, not waiting for a manager to help you along, not waiting for a mentor to pop up. And on the other side, as developing others, it's not waiting for somebody to come to you either, right? So if we take ownership, we're most often, well, we're totally, it's in our control. So you can move that forward on both sides of the equation. And I would like to stretch the definition of developing others as an opportunity for you to share your gifts. Each of us comes to the table with leadership gifts, and why not share those? We all have something to give. Again, being intentional about it. There's that word again. And you know, when you think about development opportunities, this conference, this symposium is actually development opportunity. We'll have breakouts. It's a great place to meet people, to learn from each other. So it's really bringing that intentionality to the equation. And then lastly is this idea of strategic investment. It's no secret, and if you go back to that slide about why people don't develop themselves and others, it takes time and it often takes money to develop yourself and others. So being strategic about how you want to spend that time is really critical to your growth, but making a commitment to do that, even if you stretch that out over 3 to 5 years looking ahead. So developing self and others can be developed in different ways. And you might guess that the first one that we typically see in an organization is the notion of development plans. Usually these are done once a year. They're often tied to an annual performance review. And those are great. I would like to challenge all of us to thinking about making those more often and maybe even more fluid to really get the bang for the buck on those. We're not going to delve deeply into any of that today because we're focusing today on two other big areas, mentoring and networking. So let me transition now to mentoring. Dr. Langer put this definition up earlier, and I love it. A couple things I would point to when you think about this is the notion of engagement. To really participate in the mentoring process and get the most benefit out of it, it requires an engagement on both sides of the equation. If you are the mentor, it's usually somebody less experienced, but it doesn't have to be, by the way. It can be a peer that you view as a mentor with a diverse skill set you'd like to learn from. And the notion of nurturing, developing, and really helping another person develop those skills. The case for mentoring is compelling. Gartner Group did a study, a five-year study actually, of 1,000 employees, and 25% of the employees who enrolled in a mentoring program had a salary grade change compared to 5% of people who did not participate in a mentoring program. So if that's not compelling, I'm not sure what is. I would also say that retention rates were higher for both the mentees and the mentors than for employees that did not participate in a mentoring program. And lastly, if that's not enough, mentees are promoted 5 times more than those not in a mentoring program. Clearly, there are some real tangible benefits, along with the intangible of just basic career satisfaction, commitment, and the feeling of inclusion. When you're working with somebody, it just feels better, right? You just feel more inclusive when you have somebody to bounce ideas off of. So I'd like to have everybody raise their hand. Let's use the hand feature in Zoom. And raise your hand if you have a mentor now. Terrific. They're all popping up on my laptop. That's great. Wonderful. All right. Terrific. And oh, by the way, I should have said this earlier. I'm going to be talking more about a formal mentoring program, but you can also have mentors that are more informal. So that's great. If you could take your hands down if you haven't already, I'd like you to raise your hand for those of you who are mentoring somebody right now. Terrific. What a great group. This is fantastic. So there's obviously a lot of people already engaged. So maybe you'll have a lot more to offer in the breakouts as well, hoping for that. All right, let me move on to this notion of mutual benefit on both sides of the equation. You might notice that we have this infinity loop, and that is to indicate that it just really is a nonstop area for growth and benefit on both sides. So on the mentor side, we've talked about the personal fulfillment end of it. It just feels good to help somebody else. Most of the time when people are mentors, they suddenly realize how much they already know. It's like, wow, I didn't know by the nature of the questions that are being asked of me that I knew so much. And that's personally rewarding as well. And then there's this opportunity, many of you mentioned in chat, the importance of listening. And there's nothing like a mentoring opportunity to help you really hone in on your listening skills and your coaching skills of someone else. On the mentee side, there is the notion of getting a different perspective from somebody, getting the support and encouragement you need when you are feeling particularly vulnerable, and just a place to unpack things that happen to you that you may not feel totally safe or confident presenting to a manager. You know, you just might need to step back in a judgment-free zone, if you will, to run some ideas off somebody. Yeah, somebody just said it's a two-way process. Yes, thank you, Shabnam. It's great. So again, I mentioned we're talking more about a formal mentoring relationship, and I'm going to put some stages here to give some thought to how to get the most out of a mentoring relationship. The first of which is, I think somebody mentioned earlier, this notion of chemistry, right? That is qualifying the fit between the two of you. How are your styles matched? Are you somebody that prefers a very direct style, or do you prefer somebody that gives you the news in a more contextual fashion? There's the development of goals, making sure the experience is relevant, and that you have the time to commit. The second area is really making sure you both understand the bounds of confidentiality. I would encourage, again, to reinforce that safe space, that everything said in a mentoring relationship is kept in a mentoring relationship unless each of you agree otherwise. It just makes it feel a much safer environment. Here's where you work through logistics. Back in the days of face-to-face, and hopefully in future, that might include face-to-face, but logistics might be how often and where and when, right? What time of day, all those logistical types of things. And how will we measure success against the goals we've established in phase one? Then there is reflection and growth. That is reflection, I would say, is the most important part, and that came up in the chat. Really taking that step back and assessing what's happened between sessions with a mentor. Let's unpack those. Let's problem solve those. Get the lessons learned out. And the thing I find is most difficult for high-performing individuals is this notion of celebrating the wins. We are often, as high-performing people, very hard on ourselves. So we always want to make space for the wins and reflect on those as well. And then lastly, to close out, really reflecting on the journey. When you are ending a mentoring relationship, it's great to identify what are the takeaways, what do you want to take forward, express gratitude, and how is your support system going to work moving forward? Maybe it's time to move on to a new mentor. Maybe you need a little bit of a break, but really getting clear about that. So the key characteristics of a mentoring relationship are, first of all, is this person that you're going to work with a trusted advisor? Do you feel safe? Do you feel free to share at your most vulnerable? Will this person provide guidance and ideas to help you address tricky situations? Is this person supportive? Will they support you in a non-judgmental way when you're making mistakes? Will this person keep you off the ledge when you need it most? Is this person a role model? Does he or she exhibit traits you aspire to have as a leader? And do you have an opportunity to see this person in action? That's a really terrific setup if you do. We don't often have that. So if you can, look for that and go for that. Is this person politically savvy? Let's face it, knowing how to navigate through an organization is really critical. So you want to team up with somebody, especially if that's something that you struggle with, that can help you with that with a sense of grace. And lastly, back to the notion of time, right? What amount of time is this person willing to commit? And I always like to ask, is this person going to be open to I'll call it a May Day call? Sometimes the meatiest conversations are those that happen when you are feeling, something not so great has happened and you really need to unpack it quickly. Is this person going to be available for that? Okay. The one thing, and this was mentioned earlier as well, that I'd like to leave you with is that mentors are different than sponsors. And let me share with you the primary difference is that a sponsor is a senior level advocate. And the way I like to frame this is somebody who will support you when you're not in the room. So they will stick up for you. They will look for opportunities for you. They will recommend you for opportunities when you're not there. They also provide new connections and ultimately career guidance and development. But ultimately, the thing to keep in mind is a sponsor is your advocate. Whereas a mentor may advocate, but your mentor does many more of those support functions we're looking at in that, that flower visual. So I'm going to transition to networking. And networking, like mentoring, there is a strong case behind that as well. Many benefits. A couple things you might be interested in is that 85% of positions are filled through networking. 70% of people found a job through connections within a company. And for any of you, and I'm sure most of you are active on LinkedIn, 35% of LinkedIn users got job offers from casual communications on the platform. So clearly there is a lot of benefit in networking, and today's session is a networking opportunity as well. So in chat, I'd love for you to list what comes to mind for you when you think about what makes for a strong network. Terrific. Trust, safe space, diversity, communication, support, collaboration, more trust. I love that. Yeah, great point, Suba, on sponsors, keeping them separate from mentors. Thank you for that. Inclusion, collaboration, openness. Terrific. Well, you have almost completed my next slide here. So let's see if there's some similarities. Goals-based, I talked about that earlier, this notion of for mentoring, being intentional and intentionally curating your network. It includes sustainable relationships. I'll talk more about that when I get into passive and active networks. Requires emotional intelligence. It requires a growth and service mindset, right? When you are networking, a lot of times we're thinking about what we want to get from it. I would like to encourage everyone to think about what you have to give. That's the emotional connection, emotional intelligence connection, is being clear on your value. And it's focused on quality. Most of us have really large networks, and I'm going to show you why it's important to focus on quality and how you activate that network. So let's look at this. Is most of us, as I mentioned, have huge LinkedIn connections, networks outside of LinkedIn, and that's phenomenal, and we need that, absolutely. But I'm going to call that most often our passive network. And we've built that throughout our career. It's made up of a variety of people. We have clients, customers, business partners, professional boards, volunteers. What's not important is the titles here, but that it is made up of a diverse set of people. The main thing to bring when you think about quality of network is to keep in mind your goals. So in the value you need from the network and the value you can give. So if all of these are value that you get, we get from a network, sponsorship, feedback, problem solving, emotional support, ideation, what really matters is how we bring people in to help us address those goals. So these goals are, let's say feedback. You want somebody, you look at your network and you say, wow, who can I bring in that can help me with that? So this is where the quality aspect comes to bear. This is when we think about, it's not enough just to have thousands of LinkedIn people, again, not to disparage that because we need it. But the point here is our network is fluid and we want to tap in based on what we need most. So, how do we do that? Well, you've heard me say this probably repeatedly, is that I would encourage you to think about it beginning with goals. What are the goals you have in mind when you think about what you need from your network? Is it to get a new job? Is it to attract highly qualified people into your organization? Is it to make more money? Is it to get more exposure? It's endless in terms of the different reasons we need a network. Then take an inventory, and I'm going to show you a tool in just a minute in terms of how to take that inventory. From there, we assess the strengths and the breadth of our network. We identify the holes, develop a plan, and execute. And then, as you might expect, because it's a circle visual, we rinse and repeat based on how we articulate or what our goals are. And I'm going to show you an example, and this will lead us into our breakout, which will give everybody a chance to give this a try. So stick with me here. So there's a simple tool, even though it looks maybe a little bit more complex, that will walk us through these steps. So the first thing I said is articulating a goal. In this particular person's case, what came in is this notion of, boy, I'd like to gain external recognition for my contributions. Then top of mind, don't look in your LinkedIn network, just top of mind, jot down who comes to mind across these different categories, and don't be married to these categories. Just think about, do I know any board members? Do I have any colleagues? If you need to rename these, that's completely fine as well, as there is an others field too. But in this particular person's case, they ended up with three board members. They ended up with three colleagues, but as you can see, not much in the volunteer area. Then checking is, are they engaged? Is this somebody that I've called in the last month, let's say? And you can define what that means to you. But right there, you have a smattering of people that could be of some help to you in gaining external recognition for contributions, if that's your goal. From there, you move from left to right, and that is looking at those values that were in that center of the visual, the circle that I showed you earlier, and checking off, okay, so is this person great for connections? Is this person great for emotional support? Is this person somebody I would love to bounce ideas off of? Once that is determined, you can then identify your holes. And in this case, this person very quickly could determine that, I have a hole here in mentoring, and I have a hole in professional development. It's an opportunity for me to look at how to fill my network to accomplish this goal. And then from there, the person can make their plan, work to fill the holes. What might be a plan here? Well, I might go to some of these people that are great at connections and ask them, you know, do you have any opportunity? Do you know anybody that could help me with a mentoring relationship? So it's actually using what your strengths are here to help you fill those holes. Okay. So in closing, if you remember nothing else, I would like you to remember the following. Developing self and others is an essential leadership ingredient to your career progression. Mentoring relationships provide growth and gratification for both sides of the equation and is different than a sponsorship. And your network is another key to develop yourself and others, and it must be intentionally curated and nurtured. So before I get to the breakout instructions, I would like you to put into chat one thing that you will take on to develop self and others beginning tomorrow. Go ahead and throw some things in chat that have come to mind for you through this. Support colleagues with skills gaps. Step out of my comfort zone. Great. Knowing my team on a one-to-one basis, finding a mentor or mentee, excellent. check in with my team on their goals, developing myself, expand my network. Fantastic. Yes, emotional intelligence. Those are great. And warms my heart to see everybody jumping in. All right. So I'm going to say thank you here, but before I part, I'm going to show you one more slide for the instructions, and then Stella's going to pick up from there. We're going to put the network inventory that you just looked at in chat. Stella just downloaded it. And we would like you to download that to your computer. And not to worry if some of you are not on your computer, if you're calling in or Zooming in on your phone, have a paper and pencil handy. We'll pull that tool up on our screen, and you can look at it and do the exact same exercise with paper and pencil or pen. And then once you have downloaded, click to go to the breakout session. And I will stop sharing at this point.
Thank you so much, Jacqueline. We will now move into our next session titled Investing in Your Network, Identifying Mentors, Sponsors, Allies, and Confidants. Please note that we will be using the breakout room function in this session. This session will be co-led by our 2019 Lead Fellow, Dr. Stella Bivel. Dr. Bivel is the Director of the Center for Health Policies and Studies in Moldova. And our 2020 Lead Fellow, Carmen Contreras. Carmen is a mental health director of Socios and Salud, Partners in Health Peru. Carmen and Stella, I will now turn it over to you both.
Thank you, Olivia, and good day to all of you, and welcome to our first practice session. I already could see the enthusiasm about the tool that Jacqueline has just shared, and everyone is looking forward to practicing it, so it's exciting. I hope you can have the time to download it and let us know in the chat if it doesn't work for you. But before we do that, I just want to reinforce what we heard, is that we need to maintain our network active. And it sounds simple, right? But actually, when I did that myself, I realized that I need to do a lot of work to maintain the network active. So also, it evolves over time. At the beginning, you have some certain goals and you look for mentors, etc. But then after a while, you actually have to put a lot of thought about why you're maintaining this active network for. So it's another learning coming along the way. So in this breakout session, you will have the opportunity to practice how to keep your professional network inventory and how to transform the passive network into an active one. Each of you will have the opportunity to start the professional network inventory, just as Jacqueline has shown in her example. I pass on to Carmen to reinforce the instruction, and we will move to breakout session. Over to you, Carmen.
Thank you, Stella. Good day to all. Before we split, let us to explain what will happen next. You will be randomly assigned to a breakout room, and your moderator will be one of the lead fellows and Jacqueline too. Stella has already shared the professional network inventory on chat. If you have not done so, please save the file on your computer and have it ready. We will be using during the session, please do it now. If you don't have a computer or if you have connect by your phone, this is okay too. During the breakout, we will project a slide with the professional network inventory, and you can get a pen and paper ready to practice. Before we do this, let's first have a poll on what is your top priority that you are interested in to grow your network right now. Look, please help me. The question is, what is your current priority for networking? Please go ahead.
So just to complement, the way this poll works is that you focus on number two, but then you still need to assign some random answers to number one, number three, and number four. We will not look at them, just focus on number two, and then we will look at the answers. Thank you.
Okay, 1 minute more. Okay, thank you everyone. And now you will be randomly assigned to a breakout room. Please join it. Each room will have a facilitator of leader fellows that will introduce herself. Once the time comes to end, you will see a message that it's time to go to the main room. And please, see you back in 15 minutes.
Yes, thank you, Carmen. Great to see everyone is for professional development and no one needs emotional support from the network. Sometimes I actually do need this. We'll see you in 20 minutes back to the main room.
Okay.
Great, looks like everyone is back in our main room. Just give it a minute or two, make sure. All right, I'm going to transition us to our next session. So thank you everyone for your engagement in our breakout rooms. Our next session is titled Mentorship Program, Elements and Success Measures. This session is co-led by 2019 Lead Fellow, Dr. Subha Raghavan. Dr. Raghavan is President of Solidarity and Action Against HIV Infection in India and our 2019 Lead Fellow, Maureen Luba. Maureen serves as an Africa Region Advocacy Advisor at the AIDS Vaccine Advocacy Coalition. I will now turn it over to you both.
Thank you, Olivia. I'm going to share my screen, Olivia. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Welcome to all of you once again. Takulandrani, that is good day or good day in Chichua from Malawi, and namaskar from India. So before I start this session, I quote Thich Nhat Hanh, who says, you cannot transmit wisdom and insight to another person. The seed is already there. A good teacher touches the seed, allowing it to wake up and sprout and grow. That is all about the mentorship. We have an exciting session today. You have heard from Anna, Jacqueline, Ingrid, and several others about various types of mentorship programs, which often depends on your stage of your career. I see we have a wide variety of participants from various stages of career and various fields. In this session, even though we do have a little bit of repetition, you will learn about what makes a good mentor, mentee, and mentorship program. We also would like to share how to measure the mentorship program within the time we have so that we can track its successes and failures. Often the good intentions alone are not adequate. The programs require a structure, commitment, and we should monitor our program. If we are unable to report back on successes of our mentorship program, our own leaders or our funders or other relevant authorities neither will allocate human resources or mentorship or mentors for the program. We have an exciting session. We have two polls. Can I request the first poll on what you would want in a mentor and mentorship, please? We encourage all of you to fill it. Requesting all of you to fill it. All the participants. It doesn't matter whether you're a mentor or a mentee or a sponsor or you're undecided, it doesn't matter. We would like to see all of you to fill this. I see that some participants are still shy or not decided. Go ahead, fill that. Thank you. So as you can see, thank you very much. Yeah, I would like you to continue to share the results. As you can see, all of you wanted a mentor who understands your strengths and weaknesses. Because as you have heard from Jacqueline and others, it's very important for all of us to act on our weaknesses. As much as we recognize our strengths, mentorship is all about having a mentor who helps with your weaknesses. They also wanted, 25% wanted a structure and measure progress. We will deal with that a little bit in this session, but we'll be very happy to share with you in breakout rooms later on. And you wanted specific goals, and you wanted the mentors to introduce to network. Exactly, this is what we are going to talk about. Thank you very much. You can take out the poll results right now. I'm going to go to the next slide. Can you remove the poll results? Okay. Olivia? Okay. So I'm going to share with you next few minutes about my experiences of mentoring over a 20-year period as a professor at Columbia University, assistant professor at Columbia University, and also as a president of a large national public health institution. The first aspect is it's very important to match between a right mentor with a mentee. That usually doesn't happen often. So in that case, when you don't have, you may not get an ideal mentor in one mentee. In that time, you can go for 2 to 3 mentors based on your stage of career and also where you are. Once you achieve the right match, the clear terms of mentorship program should be defined. Jacqueline is our coach, and we understood that terms are so important for us. We have all learned about that, and we are using that in our program right now. And the second step is, it's very, very important that you work with a mentee to set personal and organization level goals. Again, Jacqueline has mentioned that we often do this during performance assessment, but quite often we fall short of that. So setting up this personal and organization goals are very, very important. The next aspect is, once you have the goals, if you don't agree on a mentorship plan with specific reference to type and frequency of meeting and calls, and in absence of these meetings and calls, the mentorship program will not be effective. It is so important. Jacqueline has calls with us every month, and that really helped us during our fellowship. And I'm also using that same practice again back in India. The mentor should be willing to share both success and weaknesses. Quite often we feel mentors are role models so that everything they have is all wins, but they have a lot of failures. It is so important, both mentee and mentor, to be comfortable to share both successes and failures. There are many ways for the mentors to work together. There's just not one way. You can attend conferences together. You can provide feedback on training. You can ask feedback in grants and papers, and you can shadow. And there are many, many ways of working together. And you had a fabulous session right now on networking. And you can also ask the mentor to introduce you to experts and serve as a champion. We have heard a lot about that. With this sharing, I hand over the session to Maureen Weaver for next objective. Maureen, to you, please.
Thank you so much, Dr. Suba. If you can move to the next slide. So for the next poll, we just wanted to get your feedback and understanding on what do you look for when measuring success of a mentorship program. And as you can see from the screen, we have about six options, but you can only choose one. And I'll give you a few minutes for you to respond. And if you're not able to participate because of the technology or the device, or probably the device that you're using, please feel free to take a pen and just write down your answer. So let's keep voting. Olivia Oluk, once we have all the results, you can actually show them on the screen. I'm not able to see the results from the poll. Okay, can we have the results now? Okay, perfect. So, I mean, as you can see from the results of the poll, it looks like when it comes to measuring the success of a mentorship program, the majority of us obviously look for improved knowledge, leadership, and technical skills. And just to mention that there's no wrong or right answer here, all the six attributes listed above are actually critical in measuring the success of a mentorship program. So in the next few minutes, allow me just to expound more on some of the key attributes, you know, that are really important when it comes to measuring the success of a mentorship program. Next slide, please. Suba, next slide.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. So as you heard from Suba, of course, the first thing is adherence to the plan. And as you heard from Suba, before you began or begin on or embark on any mentorship journey, it's always important, you know, to set some goals and develop a clear plan with some clear timelines in terms of what will it take to achieve the set goals. You know, they say a goal without a plan is like a daydream. And adherence to this mentorship plan, as well as the timelines, is very key for a successful mentorship program. And quite related to that, of course, is commitment, right? And here when I'm talking about commitment, I'm talking about commitment from both the mentor and the mentee. And and Jacqueline also talked about that it should be from both sides, and both sides should actually be fully engaged. From a personal experience, I've actually noticed that, you know, if both sides are not putting in the amount of required effort in the mentorship program, the commitment can lag over time. And it's always important to make sure that you keep the program quite exciting and quite engaging. Again, another critical attribute for measuring the success of a mentorship program is, of course, achievements of results. So the goals. Goals are even more meaningful, you know, when we are able to achieve them. Another critical component attribute, which also Jacqueline, you know, somehow touched on, is that measuring the progress. It's always important, for one to be able to know whether they are on track in terms of achieving their goals and objectives that are set at the beginning of the program. How will you know that you are lost in the woods if you're not measuring the progress of your success of your mentorship program? And success can actually be measured by looking at, for example, things like employee satisfaction, beneficiary satisfaction from within your organization or beyond your organization. You can also get a lot of feedback, you know, by doing the 360 degrees of feedback from our people that we work with, but also even beyond the organization, but also just looking at the promotion of mentors, that can also one of the key factors that can be used for one to be able to track progress of a mentorship program. Last, of course, which also Jacqueline touched on, is a formal closeout, all right? The mentorship program, I believe, is not meant to be a lifelong relationship. But once you feel like you've managed to achieve the goals that you had set, you know, at the beginning, at the very onset, it's always important, you know, to reflect on the journey, just like Jacqueline highlighted, but also have a formal closeout. So at the end, allow me, if you can go to the next slide, Suba. So in, with that at the end, I just want you to allow me to close with this quote from Bob Proctor, in which he says, a mentor is someone who sees talent and ability within you than you see in yourself. And they help you to bring that out in you. Thank you so much. Over to you, Dr. Suba.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Maureen. We have 5 minutes now, so we can, as we can't take questions orally, but you can write in your chat box. If you have a question, you can write that. And or you want to share a good practice, being a mentor or a mentee, you can also share that. And if there are questions, both Maureen and I would answer them in the next 5 minutes we have.
Thank you all for sticking with us thus far. We will now take our final 5 minute break. Please feel free to turn off your camera, stretch, and refresh your drinks. We will resume the event in 5 minutes with our final session titled Mentorship Meeting for Early Career Global Health Professionals. During this next session, you will put your new skills to practice by connecting with other global health professionals from around the globe. See you all in 5 minutes. Hello, everyone. Welcome back from the break. During our next session titled Mentorship Meeting for Early Career Global Health Professionals, we will be utilizing the breakout room feature for you all to connect with other professionals. This session will be introduced by Dr. Shabnam Sarfraz and Ada Kurtovic. Ada Kurtovic is a 2020 Lead Fellow and the Executive Director at Partnerships in Health in Bosnia. I will now turn it over to you both.
Thanks, Olivia. And we are so very excited that we are finally coming to a session where we'll get to interact with you all, learn about you. And all these events are so phenomenal in building networks. And we hope that some of these relationships that we will develop in the subsequent session, we will be able to carry them along. Four of my mentees who were with me in 2019, in one of these such breakout session in a conference, we're here today. So extremely excited to be moving to this session. You will be all be distributed into randomly with the seven fellows, and also Jacqueline, our leadership coach, has also offered to do one session. So we will get a chance to learn about you. And at the end, we will, I think this is the last session that we have. And we're really excited that we are now getting into some real action now. So I think we can, either do you have anything to add, or else we can just ask Luke to just distribute us and see who we are with in the next 40 minutes, I think we have for the session.
Thank you, Shabnam. Nothing much to add, apart of to share the excitement of everyone. Having everyone, all of us today here together, and let's spare time for the group work, because at the last session with small groups, it felt like we need a little bit more time. So let's keep our time for the group work, and looking forward to see you in my group. So thank you, Shabnam.
Celebration. We Celebrate and have a good time.